Good evening, friends. My name is Judith Clarjune. I'm one of the co-chairs of the Antoinette Brown Lectures, along with Anita Peebles, Lauren Tillman, Tamara French, and Leela Oakley. On behalf of the committee, I would like to welcome you all to the 43rd Annual Antoinette Brown Lecture. I would also like to thank all of those who have made this possible, particularly Sylvia Sanders-Kelly, Dean Emily Towns, Shatika Brown, and Dr. Ebony Marshall Terman. This lecture series is named for Antoinette Brown, the first woman ordained to Christian ministry in the United States. As a student at Oberlin Theological Seminary, Brown was accepted into the Theological Studies program to study congregational ministry, but on the condition that she would not be formally recognized. Upon graduation, she pursued writing for Frederick Douglass's abolition journal, North Star, for several years until she was licensed to preach by the Congregational Church in 1851. This lectureship recognizes her as an important part of women's ministerial history in this country. In the 1960s, when Oberlin Theological Seminary merged with Vanderbilt Divinity School, Antoinette Brown's history of agitation on behalf of women's and ministry became part of the fabric of Vanderbilt. The Antoinette Brown Lecture Series is made possible through the generous gift of Sylvia Sanders-Kelly. In the 1920s, Florrie Wilkes Sanders, Sylvia Kelly's mother, was a student at Yale Divinity School who was told by her professors that she had to sit in the back so as to not distract the real students, the men. In this legacy, the Antoinette Brown Lectures began in 1974 with the intention of bringing distinguished women theologians to the school in order to speak on concerns for women in ministry. Through these lectures, we continue to affirm and elevate that it is necessary to center and privilege the voices of women, trans and non-binary folks, particularly those who are most marginalized among us. Since 1974, we have hosted a number of theologians ranging from Katie Geneva Cannon, Rita Nakashima Brock, Renita Weems, and Amy Jill Levine. The Antoinette Brown Lectures continue to be a space for women and non-binary theologians to challenge, enrich, and speak truth to the many facets of what their particular identities means in the context of ministry in our current time. This year's lecture, titled Facing Pecola, Towards a Soteriologic of Black Girl Disrespectability, will be presented by Dr. Ebony Marshall Terman. Now, I welcome our very own Dean Emily Towns, who will introduce this evening's speaker. Thank you.
Good evening, one and all. It's good to have you join us tonight. And it is a special delight for me because I knew Dr. Terman when. And it is a joy to have her address us tonight in this manner. As you know, the 2017 Antoinette Brown Lecturer is the Reverend Dr. Ebony Marshall Terman. She is Assistant Professor of Theology and African American Religion at Yale University Divinity School, and formerly served as Assistant Research Professor of Theological Ethics, Black Church Studies, and African and African American Studies, and the director of the Office of Black Church Studies at Duke University Divinity School. Dr. Terman earned her BA degree in philosophy and doctor of philosophy degrees in social ethics from Union Theological Seminary in the city of New York. She is the youngest woman to be named assistant minister of the historic Abyssinian Baptist Church in New York City, where she served for 10 years, and the second woman to preside over the ordinances in its 209-year history. She is the only womanist theological ethicist on the faculty of Yale University's Divinity School, one of Ebony Magazine's Young Faith Leaders in the Black Community, included on the Network Journal's prestigious 40 Under 40 list, and recently named as one of the top 5 young preachers in America. I am not going to read the rest of what I printed here because it sounds far too formal and leaves out far too much. A woman who knows the importance of movement and dance as a former Alvin Ailey dancer, a woman who incorporates that sense of the body and the potential for the body, and particularly Black bodies, as we move through space, as we ponder the imponderable, and we are finally very human in the process. Tonight, she's going to drop some wisdom on Vanderbilt and the larger Nashville community. The title of her lecture, as you can see, is Facing Pakola, Toward a Womanist Soteriologic of Black Girl Disrespectability. After the lecture, we will have a question and answer period that will be followed by a reception in the Divinity School's reading room, just out this door and round the corner, and all are welcome. Please join me tonight in welcoming the Reverend Dr. Ebony Marshall Terman.
I am so very honored to be with you all on the occasion of Vanderbilt Divinity School's 43rd annual Antoinette Brown Lecture. My life and my work has been directed toward thinking about and advocating for and practicing as a Black woman in ministry. My decidedly womanist outlook has been honed under the pedagogical precision of your dean and one who I acknowledge as my beloved academic mother, Emily M. Towns. I'm eternally grateful for the work she has done with me and for me. I'm grateful for her working with God and a host of other women, some of whom are here tonight, Dr. Floyd Thomas, Dr. Shepherd, to save my life. I would like to also thank the distinguished faculty who are present tonight, the administration, Shatika, for all you have done to make it possible for me to be here today, to the students and to the members of the Greater Nashville community. I greet you this evening with lots of love and certainly in the struggle. The lecture is titled Facing Pakola Toward a Womanist Soteriologic of Black Girl Disrespectability. I don't think us feel old at all. I think this is the youngest we ever felt. Amen. These are the concluding words of prayer uttered by Alice Walker's renowned protagonist, Celie, in the Broadway production of The Color Purple. Having traced the life, the love, and troubles of a battered and abused adolescent Black girl in the 20th century American South, Through her staggeringly painful, though self-redemptive journey to middle-aged womanhood, as the storyline draws to a close, Celie utters these words, "I think this is the youngest we ever felt." She utters these words to convey the feelings of joy, wonder, and innocence that mark the moment of reunion with her beloved sister, Nettie. After having been estranged by force for decades, the monologue that accompanies Celie and Nettie's unexpected sisterly restoration as adult women reveals an irreconcilable absurdity of Black womanhood that offers initial cause for this meditation. Namely, what Black feminist scholar Monique W. Morris has identified as the malleability of Black girlhood and Black womanhood that not only subjects black girls to aspersive representations of Black women, but even more, that compels Black girls through a gender-racialized project of age compression to be women, or at least to be womanish, rationalizing, emoting, acting, and being acted upon as adult women before fully approximating womanhood. Womanist theology and ethics has appropriated the womanist designation as first defined in Walker's 1983 In Search of Our Mother's Gardens womanist prose for the task of Black women's religious and theological reflection in order to faithfully attend to the distinct epistemes, those ways, as Stacey Floyd Thomas might say, of knowing, being, and doing that both distinguish and circumscribe the lives and spiritual witness of Black women. What womanist theological inquiry has done less of is explore the inherent continuity between the lived realities of Black womanhood and Black girlhood, especially in relationship to the hegemonic imagination of white patriarchy and its concomitant misogynoir, both of which have historically looted Black girlhood and coerced the absurd interchangeability of Black women and girls in ways that make sense of Mariah Stewart's mid-19th century reflection on Black women's stages of life that concedes most of our color have dragged out a miserable existence from cradle to grave. While recognizing the certainty of the diversity of Black girls' experiences, asserted, for example, in Bell Hooks' Bone Black, Memories of Girlhood, tonight I'd like to presuppose moral continuity between Black girlhood and Black womanhood and endeavor to begin uncovering a genealogy of Black women's suffering that didn't just grow, but that emerges out of a precise and unscrupulous historical denigration of Black girls in the U.S. Building upon Emily M. Towns' treatment of Topsy as Pickaninny in her groundbreaking ethical investigation of memory and malevolent imagination, this talk embraces Topsy as counter-narrative to locate the ethical origins of Black women's suffering in an initial subjection and erasure of Black girlhood that manifests in both church and society, and resonates with Celie's paradoxical midlife confession in prayer, "This is the youngest we ever felt." Following Joyce Ladner's pioneering work in Girlhood Studies, which persuasively contends that Black girls are, quote, socialized into womanhood as early as 7 or 8 years old, end quote, tonight I'd like to cast this reality as a moral problem by critically asking why girlhood is so often denied to Black girls, while also attending theologically to the ways in which many Black girls renounce and resist this brazen contradiction. To be sure, the intergenerational character of the first part of Walker's four-part definition, quote, "From the Black folk expression of mothers to female children, you acting womanish. For example, like a woman," usually referring to outrageous, audacious, courageous, or willful behavior, wanting to know more and in greater depth than is considered good for one, interested in grown-up doings, acting grown-up, being grown-up, interchangeable with another Black folk expression, "You trying to be grown." responsible, in charge, serious. The intergenerational character of the first part of Walker's four-part definition appears, at first glance, to affirm and celebrate this womanish black girl reality that incubates the radical subjectivity required of black women to brave a house wherein, as black feminist A. Gloria Hull surmised, all the women are white and all the blacks are men. I want to be, however, careful to distinguish between what the definition uncovers as voluntary desire, for example, wanting to know more, to distinguish between what the definition uncovers as intellectual sophistication, for example, interested in grown-up doings, play, acting grown-up, and the attempt toward ontic presuppositions of black womanhood, trying to be grown, as indicated in the definition, distinguishing between these things and the external coercion of black girl dispossession that is propelled by a normative revulsion for the embodied interdigitation of subjugated social indices, namely race, gender, class, sexuality, and generation, that typically guides the moral compass of the arbiters of power. I want to acknowledge such aggressive compulsion as a form of gender-racialized moral pedicide, that is, the social and moral slaughter of black girls as structural and systemic evil that is too often also intimately enacted as individual sin. In making such a moral claim, tonight I begin with an examination of the textures of black girls' social and moral crucifixion, by focusing on their respective criminalization and demonization at the hands of anti-black state-sanctioned and anti-black church-sanctioned gender terror. An exploration of the nature of suffering in the lives of black girls will follow and assert black girlhood as a theological problem to which the black church must be held accountable. The constructive edge of the paper finally contends that the disrespectability attributed to black girls is in fact a responsible and deeply embodied soteriologic. In other words, black girl disrespectability functions as its own enfleshment of a salvific logos toward the end of black girl redemptive self-love. 16-year-old Ashlyn Avery, assaulted by police and arrested for falling asleep in class while reading Huckleberry Finn. 17-year-old Marche Taylor, arrested for being barred from prom for wearing a dress that was considered too revealing. 17-year-old Pleasia Mervin, assaulted by police and arrested for refusing to pick up a piece of cake that she had dropped on the cafeteria floor. 6-year-old Desiree Watson, arrested for throwing a tantrum in her kindergarten class. 7-year-old Ayanna Monet Stanley Jones, shot and killed by Officer Joseph Weekly while sleeping in the home of her paternal grandmother. 15-year-old Jasmine Darwin, assaulted by a police officer while trying to break up a fight at Roseville High School in Wake Forest, North Carolina. These are the names of just a few black girls who have been publicly crucified by the staggering escalation of the criminalization of black girls in the U.S. public education industrial complex, specifically, and the concurrent rise, at least in terms of visibility, of anti-black state-sanctioned violence more generally. And since I've said their names, let me add a few more. Rakia Boyd, Kendra Chapman, Ralkina Jones, Raynette Turner, Sandra Bland. Or how about the missing black girls in Washington, D.C.? Jacqueline Lassie, Yeshaya Enoch, Keon Herder, Juliana Otero, Deshaun Walker, Anaya McNeil, Deanna White, Talisha Coles, Morgan Richardson, Shania Boyd, Sharia Payne, Relisha Rudd. Let's not forget Breisha Meadows. And our trans sisters, Misha Caldwell, Kiki Colker, and how about the 15-year-old girl gang-raped on Facebook Live, and nobody except her mother said a mumbling word? In February 2015, the African American Policy Forum, a Columbia University-based think tank oriented toward dismantling structural inequality through the propagation of intersectional analyses, frameworks, and strategies that combat racial and gender injustice, released a groundbreaking study on the issue of the ever-growing criminalization of black girls, titled Black Girls Matter: Pushed Out, Overpoliced, and Underprotected. The study uncovers the debilitating social and political trends that disproportionately affect the flourishing of black girls in the public square. Circulated on the heels of President Barack Hussein Obama's widely celebrated launch of My Brother's Keeper, the White House initiative aimed at empowering boys and young men of color who face disproportionate challenges and obstacles to success, the African American Policy Forum's Black Girls Matter garnered considerable attention, as with empirical precision, its deliberate focus on black girls' lives pressed beyond the absurdity of 21st century gender hierarchies to challenge the meta-narrative of male exceptionalism and its culture of exclusion that invisibilizes black girls, even on Facebook Live, and in so doing implicitly asserts that black girls do not matter. Monique Morris employs the African American Policy Forum study in Push Out, the criminalization of black girls in schools, to deepen her analysis of the complexity of black girls' marginalization that results in a disproportionate school-to-confinement pathway for black girls in relationship to non-black girls. While only constituting 16% of the female student population, black girls make up close to one-third of all girls referred to law enforcement and more than one-third of female school-based arrests. Morris contends that the mark of double jeopardy, namely black girls' racial and gender subordination, fuels their push out. Combined with the marginalized economic, sexual, and generational realities that disproportionately distinguish the lives of black girls, such double jeopardy is intensified by what I might call an insidious pentagonal social subjugation. As noted above, the hostility and aversion that condemn the intersection of race, gender, class, sexual, and generational subordinate realities provoke policies, practices, and consciousness that promote black girl invisibility and that facilitate her criminalization, her demonization, and her invisibilization. Accordingly, Morris uncovers how the varieties of intersectional social subjectivity position black girlhood within a taxonomy of deviance that imagines and brands her as bad, loud, defiant, irate, insubordinate, disrespectful, uncooperative, uncontrollable, and thus the antithesis of the protected and racially specific category, girl. Such caricatures of black girls sometimes are based on behavioral distinctions that arise no doubt from the specificity of social location and context. But they are also and too often attributed to them due to a fabricated complementarity between black girl aesthetics and oppressive racial gender tropes that objectify and strip black girls of their girlhood. At times, caricature performs as a messy third way that exists somewhere between the sometimes true of black girl behavior and the true of racial gender tropes that oppress in ways that resonate with the ethical almostness that, echoing Gramsci's Meditations on Hegemony, Emily Towns asserts as a viable counter-narrative. We will return to this later as we engage toward thinking critically about black girl disrespectability. Suffice it to say for now that the black female child and or adolescent subject is not girl, insofar as she is perceived as radical other in relationship to meta-assessments of girlhood, those social and moral calculations that almost always imply white girl or Becky with the good hair, who is fictively constituted as respectable, kindly, and penetrable via physical and emotional vulnerabilities that are real and yet simultaneously not true, though consistent with the debility of white women's tears and the defective logics of Victorian domesticity. Black girl defiance of the ever calcifying white supremacist gendered racial order designates her loud, outrageous, and courageous misbehaving body as illicit and criminal. It presupposes her subjection to exclusionary technologies of racialized gender terror that surveil and contain. In accordance with literary analysis as black womanist ethical method, the weight of black girls' flesh and blood subjection to technologies of discipline can readily be found in the literary enunciation of black girl social crucifixion. In reflecting on the impetus behind her classic, The Bluest Eye, Toni Morrison insists that the black female child is society's most vulnerable member. Pronouncing the woundedness and estrangement of her novel's protagonist, Pecola Breedlove, Morrison attempts to uncover what she identifies as the social and domestic aggression that injures young black girls who are subject to the damaging forces of youth, gender, and race. Facing Pecola, the elusive nature of black girlhood, especially in its encounter with white male antipathy, is palpable. Quote, "She looks up at him and sees the vacuum where curiosity ought to lodge. And something more, the total absence of human recognition, the glazed separateness. She does not know what keeps his glance suspended, perhaps because he's grown, or a man, and she a girl. But she has seen interest, disgust, even anger in grown male eyes. Yet this vacuum is not new to her. It has an edge. Somewhere in the bottom lid is the distaste. She has seen it lurking in the eyes of all white people. So the distaste must be for her, her blackness. And it is the blackness that accounts for, that creates the vacuum edged with a distaste in white eyes." End quote. It is precisely the racial gender coordination of her blackness that lends itself to racialized gender terrorism, or what has been identified above as the social and moral crucifixion of black girls. The sort of violence that locates its dynamism in her blackness can be found beyond the assumed simplicity of the schoolyard and the imagined interior lives of the oppressed. As revealed in the experience of Dejeria Becton, who was 14 years old at the time of her state-sanctioned assault at a pool party in a predominantly white neighborhood to which she and other black youth had been invited, the physical dispossession of black girlhood is an imperial design such that it can happen anywhere and nowhere at all, insofar as everywhere is its domain. Let's take a look. Can you turn the volume up?
Why is he acting so crazy?
Shatika, I may need you to come and get the PowerPoint back up. Never mind. Here I am reminded of the wisdom of Miss Sophia's counsel. A girl child ain't safe in a house or church or world full of men. In the case of Dejeria Becton, however, the Free Thought Project reported that a resident of the Craig Ranch North community in McKinney, Texas, where the incident occurred, called in a disturbance to the McKinney Police Department upon noticing multiple black youth, quote, who do not live in the area or have permission to be there, end quote, in and or near the community pool. Morris explains at length, quote, call my mama. This was the cry of 14-year-old Dejeria Becton, who in the summer of 2015 was thrown to the ground as well as physically and verbally assaulted by police after she refused to leave her friends at the mercy of law enforcement officers in McKinney, Texas. A video which later went viral showed Corporal Eric Casebolt pushing Dejeria's face into the ground as she, a slight frame, barefoot, bikini-clad teenager, who presented no physical threat or danger, screamed for someone to call her mother for help. The video showed Casebolt grinding his knee into her bare skin and restraining her by placing the full weight of his body onto hers, end quote. The visibility of Becton's experience exposes a state-sanctioned menace to black girlhood and black youth broadly construed. Close review of video of the incident shows that prior to Becton's assault, a group of black adolescent girls was standing by as police aggressively rounded up several of their black male peers while relatively disregarding the comparable presence of white youth, male and female. As the girls prepared to walk away after having been instructed by the police to do so, an animated verbal exchange between the girls and the police ensued. From the video, it appears that as Becton, slight frame, barefoot, bikini-clad, walked away from the dispute, it seemed she realized she was walking by herself in the opposite direction of her girlfriends. As she turned to change her course, Corporal Casebolt physically accosted her and violently pulled her to the ground in a manner more consistent, rather more consonant, with a defensive response to a threatening adult offender, though even then still questionable. In an instant, Becton's weekend pool party girlhood evaporates as her willful adolescent behavior is perceived by the disconscious racism of state power, which is almost always synonymous with white power, as criminal activity, and her blackness condemned as ground zero for the performance of anti-black girl rage and brutality that defies modern concepts of reasonable post-war child-adult interactions. In No Mercy Here, Gender Punishment and the Making of Jim Crow Modernity, Sarah Haley argues that historically the criminal legal system has crafted, reinforced, and required black female deviants in order to justify the extension of structures of captivity. Echoing Hortense Spillers, Haley further contends that the gendered logics of punishment, its systems of terror and structures of subordination, perceive the black female subject as the principal point of passage between the human and the non-human world, the route by which the dominant modes decided the distinction between humanity and other. When read in tandem with childhood studies that assert the flexibility of ideology at the conjunction of childhood and innocence, classifying black children, black girls in particular, for our purposes here, as unfeeling, non-innocent, non-children, a precise connection may be drawn between how racialized, gendered logics of punishment position the black girl as not girl in the effort to naturalize and justify anti-black pedicidal politics that cast black children into contemporary scenes of subjection. Becton's repeated cry of call my mama, however, stands in stark contrast to her abjection and palpably reveals the actuality of black girlhood in contradistinction to the perception of her adolescent girl body as adult threat at best and bestial female at worst. Lest we mistakenly think that black girls' crucifixion is unique to the public square, it must be noted that the moral crucifixion of black girls is consistently evident in the black church as well. It should be noted that black churches are not homogeneous. Not every black church is circumscribed by sexual gender injustice that targets black girls, although I would argue that too many are. As I have indicated elsewhere, my use of the black church as a rhetorical device does not endeavor to minimize the significant varieties of denominational polity and communal praxis that guide the ecclesial practice of Christian persons and communities of African descent in the U.S. It rather signifies the historical continuity and expression of black Christian faith that is no greater than the sum of its varied parts. Accordingly, the black church does not only refer to the seven primary historically black Christian denominations African Methodist Episcopal, African Methodist Episcopal Zion, Christian Methodist Episcopal, the Church of God in Christ, the National Baptist Convention of America, the National Baptist Convention USA Incorporated, the Progressive National Baptist Convention Incorporated, but it also includes those smaller historically black denominations like the Church of God, the United Holy Church of America, the Fire Baptized Holiness Church of God of the Americas, in addition to black congregations in historically white majoritized denominations, multicultural non-denominational churches as well, whose liturgical expressions are guided by the norms of African American preaching and worship traditions. Although in the past 10 to 15 years, the black church has seen a remarkable uptick in the number of women in pastoral and or ministerial leadership positions, as is evidenced by black women's disproportionate misrepresentation, or rather their relative absence, to be more precise, from the highest levels of Afro-ecclesial leadership when compared to the church's majority female constituency, I think at 92-93%. Last time I checked, a large proportion of black churches continue to prohibit black women from exercising the arts and gifts of ministry from the pulpit. In fact, in recounting this black church reality, I distinctly remember my own experience as a licensed and ordained minister in the National Baptist Convention USA, as well as a theological educator. I have been instructed to address congregations from the floor, while the platform of black male ministers ascended to the sacred desk. The masculine erection of the pulpit that notably defies black church origins as slave religion begets the sort of sexual gender discrimination that regularly excludes women from ordained ministry and restricts them to lay service like teaching in the Sunday school, singing in the choir, answering the phones, cooking in the kitchen, all of which are no doubt significant service that often constitutes the principal viability of a congregation, and that concretely serves at least two of the three tables of an ordained, though typically male, diaconate. Nevertheless, sexism in the black church does not commence in adulthood, when and if one approximates sacred consciousness and the courage to affirm call. To the contrary, the effects of sexual gender discrimination in the black church begin taking hold in childhood, wherein girls are often conditioned into a gendered variation of Du Boisian double consciousness that functions as its own sacralized schizophrenia, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one black woman child's body that is concurrently both image of God and female subject to men, echoing an Augustinian designation of women as a special symbol of evil and a Thomistic regard for women as defective and misbegotten. As I note in my forthcoming book, Black Women's Burden, Sexism, Sacred Witness, and Transforming the Moral Life of the Black Church, strong arguments can be made about the effects that the invisibilization and marginalization of black women in the church has on black girls, as well as the paralyzing theological trauma that accompanies preaching misogyny from the pulpit in ways that insult, shame, and spiritually wound. These sorts of hostile and discriminating liturgical practices have been notably recognized in, for example, the Reverend Jamal Harrison Bryant's impertinent reprimand of disloyal hoes in his now infamous sermon, I'm My Enemy's Worst Nightmare, preached at the Empowerment Temple AME Church in Baltimore, Maryland, where he is the senior pastor. Surprisingly, even the contemporary black social gospeler, the Reverend Calvin O. Butts III, and the homiletical association he has made between Hosea's whore and the Lenox Avenue hoe, in a sermon delivered at the historic Abyssinian Baptist Church in Harlem, where he is senior pastor, is likewise hermeneutically slothful and deeply problematic. Juanita Bynum's recent viral soliloquy concerning the necessity of black women's combining their hoe with God's Lee toward the approximation of divine holiness is one example of the ways in which black women participate in their own subjection through the performance of patriarchy in drag. The corresponding demonization of black girls' bodies in the black church, however, is equally intriguing insofar as it situates their bodies, apart from their practices, on the moral fault line of not girl. In this way, the black church as a supportive institution, that is, supportive of what womanist systematic theologian Kelly Brown Douglas asserts as the white cultural attack, and what black feminist anti-colonial geographer Catherine McKittrick identifies as state-sanctioned human geographies that displace and dispossess, targets not only what black girls do, but also who black girls inherently are. For black girls, then, there is seemingly no escape. While in the public square, both the schools and the streets, negation of black girlhood functions as a pathway toward the subhuman criminal, literally dragging black girls to prone positions, where, as we have seen with Dejeria Becton and even Shakara, the 16-year-old black girl known only by her first name, who in October 2015 was assaulted and dragged from her math class by school police at Spring Valley High School in Columbia, South Carolina. They can also be incapacitated and sat upon by the arbiters of power as if inanimate objects. At the same time, in the black church, the negation of black girlhood functions as a pathway toward her objectification, not so much as subhuman, but as sinner. One way that black girlhood is pilfered in the black church is through the prioritization of what I have discussed elsewhere as the cover-up, literally lap scarves, turtlenecks, and hose, but this time I mean pantyhose, that police the bodies of women and girls so they will not primarily awaken, so they will not primarily awaken the wanton passions of cishet in public clergy and churchmen who are, due to the malformed privilege of patriarchy, presumed incapable of regulating their own wills to power. The cover-up also underscores a theologically deformed Platonism, most often attributed to Pauline influences, that impart a fundamental and particular in-flesh deviance to black bodies. Because black girls inhabit the potential lasciviousness typically reserved for black women, as has been observed in the bizarre and fanatical public infatuation with Michelle Obama's body, and has cast it as varied spectacle based on the myth of black female bodily deviance, black girls' bodies must be covered up in ways that approximate an illusory and thus impossible respectability, one that black girls and black women can never really possess because they are not white. In other words, Pakola's bluest eye eludes black girls, even as it is peddled as a violent liturgical racial gender self-loathing, what Morrison asserts as the internalization of assumptions of immutable inferiority originating in an outside gaze that colors and condemns too many black churches. Black girl joy and pain. The despoiling of black girls' lives through their moral and social crucifixion in church and society is a theological problem. It is rooted in a systemic and structural objectification of life that, while caricaturing black girls as some amalgamation of subhuman sinner, alienates them from the ways and the will of God through physical and ecclesial violence that criminalizes and literally condemns them, in some instances, to hellfire and damnation via sexist liturgical practices, or at least hell on earth, at school and at the swimming pool. To be sure, the theological production of black female juvenile deviance is part of a broader constitution of Jim Crow modernity, premised upon the devaluation of black life, broadly speaking, which is why liberationist theological trends contend that theological inquiry, apart from historical and sociological analysis, is inadequate and futile at best. Even traditional white Trinitarian commitments would affirm Rahner's stimulating axiom, which contends irrevocable continuity between the economic and immanent trinity, namely that God and the world are bound together. Thus, the brilliance of, for instance, Kelly Brown Douglas' theological treatment of state-sanctioned violence against black bodies in her Stand Your Ground, Black Bodies and the Justice of God, is indisputable. She carefully traces the phenomenon of the guilty black body in the U.S., that is, the criminal and sinful non-white body, to the Anglo-Saxon chauvinism upon which the grand mythos and theology of American exceptionalism, the kind that formerly made a liturgy out of its history of planting a colony for the glory of God on top of indigenous people, and the kind that contemporarily propels trumped up and violence-laden claims that propose to make America great again by making America first, Brown Douglas is tracing the peculiarity of how the theology of the guilty black body at work in both church and society takes root with exacting consequences for black youth. As it relates to black girls, though, the strange fruit of the white Christian imagination that emerges from its prevailing theology of triumphalism and its concomitant mythos of white exceptionalism has historically been transmitted in the particularity of designating the black child as non-child or as pickaninny. For our purposes here, the pickaninny is a subhuman black girl, void of innocence, who, as queer cultural historian Robin Bernstein advances, merrily accepts or even invites violence, precisely because of her presumed inability to feel pain. Although the word pickaninny is derived from the Portuguese pequenino, meaning small child, its usage can be traced back to the 17th century pejorative reference to any child of African descent. Interestingly enough, by the 19th century, it mainly referred to black children in the US and Britain, as well as to non-black Aboriginal children of the Americas, Australia, and New Zealand, who, as children of color, were absorbed into blackness according to the logics of black-white dyadic hierarchies. While the pickaninny was a routine caricature of black children throughout American slavocracy and well into the early 20th century, it must be observed that she has not vanished, and in fact continues to not only embellish the kitchenware and mantelpieces of many 21st century homes, but also tragically continues to guide social interactions with black youth in church and society. Bernstein explains that the pickaninny, the juvenile childlike Negro stripped of her childhood, as she is simultaneously always already an adult, is typically characterized as dark-skinned with exaggerated facial features. Bernstein further clarifies that the pickaninny is almost always represented as the target for an animal attack. Quote, pickaninnies often wear ragged clothes, which suggests parental neglect, and are sometimes partially or fully naked. Genitals or buttocks are often exposed and not infrequently targeted for attack by animals. When threatened, pickaninnies might ignore danger. When attacked, they might laugh. But in either case, they never experience or express pain or sustain wounds. It is the absence of pain that unifies the construction of the pickaninny. Bernstein also contends that some pickaninnies, like the Cottalene girl, were depicted as clean, well-dressed, and engaged in domestic chores in ways that could infer an adorable childlikeness that was never to be mistaken for innocence or even humanness. As William Cowper Brand notes, quote, there is probably nothing on earth cuter than a nigger baby, but like other varieties in the genus coon, they are not valuable additions to society, end quote. The pickaninny is rooted in a Christian imagination, propelled by white exceptionalism that, as Brown Douglas contends, guides America's grand narrative. The image of the non-innocent, non-child, black juvenile subject in church and society proves to be, echoing Beverly Harrison, its own sinful brand of Christian sadomasochism that requires pain as